Perfect, guys. Welcome, welcome. Welcome to another exciting Startup Grind SG virtual event with an amazing guest. We have Marjorie in the house. We are super excited. But before we are kicking things off, I know people are still dialing in. People are in the waiting room, so I need to keep an eye on that. So we just give you a quick overview of Startup Grind. Make yourself comfortable, enjoy the evening, and I'll see you in a minute.
At one point, I really realized I want to be surrounded by people who really want to change something. Entrepreneurs, community builders, people who really want to move something around.
It's truly an amazing experience. For me, it was really a good entry point to enter the startup world. So my background is in finance and investing. I went to the Europe conference in London and then attended my first global conference last year and this year again. I met so many interesting people. If you have any hesitations, you truly need to get connected in your local chapter.
Basically, what we do is try to reach for the best speaker possible that will allow founders to learn. You have to meet a lot of people and you have to create a real connection with those people, focusing on adding value to their lives, but also in learning and helping them in every way you can and to scale faster.
Startup Grind gave me the opportunity to really achieve that. So now I'm running one of the most active chapters in China and in the world. And I am on a daily basis meeting so amazing people, entrepreneurs, investors, corporates. I'm really grateful being part of this amazing community.
San Francisco.
Lagos.
New York City.
Dubai.
Dublin.
Auckland.
China.
And obviously SG Berlin, and I'm not sure whether the audio was there, but we still hope that you get something out of it.
It's so. Always a magical moment just to see the memories with our international community. And we will say a few words maybe at the end of the evening, because we're all conscious of time, and let's dive into the slides maybe, Verena.
Yeah.
Because actually today we're doing it a little different. So normally we give a shout out also to the community a bit, but now since Marjorie has had a little injury herself and we're super grateful for her time, we want to keep it as short and precise as possible, get the most out of her time, out of your time. So we will deep dive into our fireside chat in a second. Also, we encourage you to ask a lot of questions. Just put them into the chat box. There's not really any structure that you need to follow. We will just probably either address them on the go, or also if we have time at the end, we have like 5 to 10 more minutes. Obviously, I want to, if you have questions, please engage with us. Although we are still virtual and this madness is still going on, I'm an optimistic, positive person. So let's make the most out of this exciting evening. And then also at the end, we give a little shout out what's next with Startup Grind, new events, and also like our partners.
Cool. Thank you, Marijke. Then I would say, let's get started. So before we also dive into the whole topic, maybe you, Emery, maybe you can just give us a little bit of a background, also how you actually founded the company, what brought you to the whole founding experience. Just give us a little bit of a background.
Yeah, for sure, with pleasure. So as you guys know, I'm Marjorie Hernandez. I'm originally from Venezuela. I moved to Germany over a decade ago, I think 12 years ago or even longer, to do my master's degree in Weimar, of all places. My first degree was in architecture and my second degree was in media, art and design. That was the one I did here in Germany. When I graduated from architecture school after 6 years, I was very happy that I studied architecture and I love architecture, but the speed of the process of the projects is very slow, right? Like architectural projects mostly take like a decade to develop. So that was something that was turning me off a little bit. I also graduated awfully young. I graduated with 22 of my, with bachelor's and master's, which was insane. So I decided to explore other avenues. The great thing is, about my background as an architect and from the education perspective is we have a really great training that involves like a lot of like engineering, but also a lot of like product management and also like very creative work. So it's like a very good foundation for other stuff. And you know how to choose good furniture. So that's another perk. And, you know, so I came to Germany, did this master's, and then around right after I graduated, me and my partner, we moved to Berlin. Before moving to Berlin, we started investing in Bitcoin around 2013, and we became very interested on the whole blockchain technology. We moved to Berlin and we both have different jobs. He was working as a developer in the startup scene, and I was working doing a lot of brand strategy and brand experience, mostly in Switzerland. So I was like going back and forth. And in that process, my partner started working on the Ethereum Foundation very early, and I moved to Ernst & Young and started leading their innovation lab for the German-speaking region, which is always like a funny joke to bring the Venezuelan to lead innovation for the German-speaking region. That was fun. And then in that process was the time where kind of like the whole blockchain technology kind of like went out of being a hobby and something that we just do for fun to be something that was part of our daily work. So when I was working in Ernst & Young, I was doing a lot of like their use cases, implementations for blockchain technology within the industries that we were serving for, like automotive, pharmaceutical, like very typical German Swiss companies. I did a lot of the stuff. I built their innovation in-house capabilities, which was a lot of fun. And then in the process of building all of these implementations of the blockchain technology, I realized, well, this is a tremendous opportunity because, you know, now the technology is exiting kind of like that developer niche circle that was known for and a slightly bad reputation. Like at the beginning was people perceived it quite bad because all of the new was Silk Road. And so people thought blockchain equals buying drugs in the internet and that's it. So in that process, you know, we realized, okay, this is changing. This is fundamentally, you know, going to change a lot of businesses. And we were pretty much in the epicenter of the whole thing. So I presented the idea to Fabian to let's start our own startup that will basically cater not for the finance world, but for the what we call the new creative economies. So we draft a paper. We went out to the world. I finally got out of my working contract. And we incorporated a company in Germany. And we decided strategically to remain as a German company for the sake of, you know, like really building trust within the industry with the partners that we wanted to kind of like work together with, making sure that we stay in a very solid jurisdiction, which implied a year and a half of work, of legal work, in order to get a proper setup for a crypto project within Germany. And you know, in the process, that was like kind of like the beginning. Maybe I should stop there, or should I carry on? Maybe I stop there. That's how it started.
And so, maybe just for the records, Fabian is your husband, your partner, co-founder?
Yes, all of it. Well, we met when we were both students, so we are, first of all, we're friends. Mm-hmm. Second enough, well, we eventually got married, which was very nice. And I like him in many ways. And then he's also my co-founder. So we hang out a lot together.
And how do you like split the roles now? Obviously, we deep dive into the host, what you actually do at Luxon, how it has evolved over the years. But like, how do you like these days, like divide your roles?
Yeah, totally. So at the beginning, it was Fabian and I most of the time. We have a very natural way of working together. We complement each other very well, but we are also a bit like iron against iron, making each other sharp. But it's also not the easiest process sometimes because you need to challenge each other. You cannot please each other. And I think this is something that you have to understand when you're a founder, is that it's not about, I mean, harmony is not only about being in agreement, but it's like about maybe we disagree, but it's for the sake of building a better product and a better project. So it shouldn't be seen as something personal, but as something that we want to achieve together. And the best idea should win. And therefore, I always encourage debates to happen. So we debate a lot. And at the beginning, you know, we were pretty much both of us doing everything, in the sense, obviously, Fabian is the main developer, and I am naturally a very good kind of like project product person. And we were doing pretty much everything together. Moving from there, you know, we have, after our fundraise and all of that, we were able to start growing the team. So right now I do a lot of management. Like I do a lot of like, you know, managing like everything that comes with operations, but also business development and maintaining, basically being that face explains the technology for other people. Yeah, thank you, Sylvia. something was missing in my house and Sylvia just found it after we were looking for 2 days. So do all of the stuff, the business development, but also very closely working with the product development. Because I think, you know, in order to make blockchain adoption actually happen, and especially for the industries that we want to address, which are fashion and creative economies and lifestyle, you know, you need to have a very specific language that is not the language developers tend to speak. So we work very closely together in that. And as part of that process, I spin up a second company called The Dematerialize, which is a digital fashion marketplace.
So many projects that you are working on. before we also dive a bit more into the vision behind Luxo, could you maybe also give us a little bit of a background about the creative industry and also how actually the blockchain technology could be useful for that?
Yeah, totally. So, you know, when we started this conversation, it was interesting because obviously the whole hype around blockchain technology was for finance and decentralized finance and, you know, all of the type of assets because it's where the value was being generated. But I, you know, we always came from the assumption, you know, yes, of course, the financial world is very important, but most of us don't get very excited about going to the bank or applying for a credit card. So this is not something that makes us excited in life. Things that make us excited are beauty, you know, entertainment, you know, art, all of those things, design, all of those things make most people very excited. And these are the products that we like to consume. So that was kind of like from the intrinsic value of where we will see blockchain mainstream adoption might be potentially from an end of a consumer good perspective. That being said, we had a very clear understanding that what blockchain can do super, super well is basically creating uniqueness for assets. And that asset can be pretty much anything from an artwork that exists once in the real world to a Birkin bag that are produced a couple of 1,000 a year, to a Chanel handbag, to a sneaker, to then moving into this digital consumption and direct to avatar, a digital asset that is actually owned by you and don't host, is not just host by the game company in a server, but it's in your ownership and you can trade it, own it, and take it into different environments. So that was kind of like the main kind of like, yeah, vision behind it was to power this economy behind these assets. And you know, that's in many ways empower creators and empowers consumers and empowers brands to actually have a very clear ownership of their IP, but as a consumer having transparency about the supply of the products, how many are in existence and things like that. So, I mean, I'm trying to say, well, a bit of everything to give a picture, you know, obviously the stuff is always a bit more complex than that. But that was kind of like the main motivation behind it.
Yeah, because I was even asking myself, because obviously with such a big mission, there are lots of challenges coming along. And one of the biggest is definitely because it's like with blockchain, it has been like in the whole DeFi that is also like so hyped, just the terminology these days.
Yeah.
But yeah, with NFTs and sports cards and digital art, even I got an account and like an Ether wallet and stuff because I just wanted to understand like, what is that all about? So maybe yeah. Can you even like shed some more light on so people who are maybe not that familiar, they have just heard it, because I still oftentimes see like, what is an NFT? Like, how would you describe it to someone who has never heard about that?
About what an NFT is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but so that just comes, you know, the term was coined non-fungible tokens. So just a token that is not divisible, right? Like most tokens, they're divisible until like 19 units or even higher than that sometimes. So this is a token that is just one unit that you can't divide, right? That doesn't mean that you can't co-own it within a group of people, but the asset itself, you know, is not dividable, just like things in the real world. If we will share this chair, I wouldn't say I buy the half, so we call it in half. That wouldn't really work, we will destroy it. So that's kind of like the premise behind non-fungible tokens, is to replicate in the digital world that ownership of a unique digital asset. So that being said, that non-fungible token can represent a physical product, a digital product, can represent, you know, the identity of a sneaker, of a piece of art, of a handbag, of pretty much anything. And, you know, this is something that, you know, we've been familiarizing, understanding for many years now, and obviously we entered this hype cycle to the insane price increase. You know, this already happened 2 years ago when Igor bought that CryptoKitty for $140,000 during the Ethereum conference in New York. So we have seen these hype cycles before. It's just that they get bigger and bigger, just like they did with Bitcoin and Ether. You know, people will crazy when the price was $1,000. Now the price is around $50,000 and people keep going even more crazy. So it's just about that. Nevertheless, it's still quite complicated. So owning a digital and an NFT is not the easiest process, right? So if you the barrier of entry is quite high. And this is one of the motivations that Fabian and I was one of our main drivers when we started Luxo was like, we want to make this stuff easy. And a lot of people don't understand, like, you can, if you receive an NFT, you generate a wallet, you receive an NFT, that's great. But in order to move the NFT, you need to have Ether in order to pay for the transaction fee. So all of a sudden, you need to buy Ether, and then you don't have them, and you don't know where to get them. So you enter, there's a lot of barriers of entry, and it's not very clear, and the products are not very clear. So it's one of the things that we're doing at Luxo, is simplifying that journey for users and creators just at large by having a very clear understanding and proposition around how a profile should look on the blockchain. And that's something Fabian has been working on in the last couple of years. And it's called, our solution is called Universal Profiles.
And where actually in like the whole industry, where do you actually position yourself with Luxo? And also, what is like right now, like what is kind of, how does the team look like? What was the development over the last time?
Well, the team is very good looking and very attractive. And you mean something else around looks? Just okay. What do you mean with the, how is it looking like? It looks like in size? How
I think the structure in general.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Like, so
also how you have evolved, right? And grown.
Yeah. Totally. So yeah, the team has grown significantly the last couple of months. We are around, I think the headcount is around 20 something. Let's say rounded up at 25. It's mostly developers. Like the core of our business is technology. So we have mostly developers. We have a very small team for marketing and for the business development part. We're kind of like starting to build, you know, more support on that end right now. A lot of it goes through me and through Junsik, who is here. So we are building up the business development team. And now we have a couple of people in different continents, which is great. And, you know, how we position ourselves is that, you know, we see ourselves like, you know, as a technology company that is providing very serious technology, but we want to make it accessible for everybody. So most of our development, or almost to 100%, is published under an open source license, because that's the only way we believe blockchain technology needs to be open source. Otherwise, nobody can really know what are you up to and if your stuff is actually legit. And you know, we see ourselves, we are like this beautiful hybrid between, you know, being very dogmatic about, you know, decentralization. But also at the same time, we see in order to achieve our goals, we have to partner with very established parties. And that's why one of the reasons our advisory board is so stellar and so cool, is because we put a lot of emphasis into kind of like building that reputation within the industries that we are addressing.
And can you elaborate like on the, because obviously now you've mentioned the stellar board, like who,
yeah.
Like how does it, like who does it consist of?
Yeah, so we have a very cool mixture between, technology people from the blockchain space and people from the lifestyle space. So our most recent addition is Eric Frunda, who was the image director of Chanel for 37 years until January, and he was the right hand of Karl Lagerfeld. He also inherited Karl's photographic work from Karl. They were best friends. So we're going to digitize that archive on Luxo. So he's one of them. The president of Chanel is also in our advisory board. A couple of executives from Burberry and Nike are in there. David Fisher, the founder of Heisnobiety, for us Berliners who know and follow Heisnobiety, he's also in there, but also like amazing developers like Peter Sigali, who is the core Go developer for the Ethereum Foundation. So he effectively leads the team that actually programs the blockchain at Ethereum. So people like that we have in our advisory board.
Sweet. Sweet. That sounds like a good line.
It was a good lineup, and it was very difficult to get them. No, it was not difficult to get them together, but the contracts were complex because, you know, we have to send advisory contracts to big companies, and, you know, it was still a long process, but we were very, very excited and happy about it.
Yeah.
And what are
go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, like, what are actually the most common use cases at Luxo that you're covering?
Yeah, so the main use cases that we're focusing on, obviously, we published an amazing white paper that I'm very proud of. It's called Blockchain for New Creative Economies. It's even better now than it was when we published it 2.5 years ago. It's 160 pages. I'm sorry that it's so long, but the chapters are very, very like little capsules. So you can just take one chapter and read it. So we go in depth in that in around like 10 use cases, very specific use cases. But the core of Luxo is about identities of people, brands, and products. So is that like how we identify the issuer of a product and how we identify the product and how a consumer can receive that NFT in a very simple manner, right? Because right now, let's say whoever brand X start issuing NFTs, how many consumers have the ability of actually receiving that NFT and doing something with it? So that's what we want to simplify. So the standard that we're working on that I mentioned before is called Universal Profiles, and it's based on the standard of having proposed ERC-725. And it's just basically a very cool advanced standard around identities on the blockchain. So it's like our main piece. It gets all demonstrated on my second venture. It's called the Dematerialized, the digital fashion marketplace. And in there, we're utilizing a lot of the key pieces that we have built on Luxo from the smart contract perspective, around like how the ownership of the products and how the products get issued and managed, et cetera, and the profiles for the users. Mm-hmm. But our game plan and the stuff that we love, obviously digital products are the ones we're most passionate about, but we still see a tremendous value in like physical products. So for example, creating digital twins for a physical good is one of the things we do as well.
And can you maybe elaborate, like, what is it, like, dematerialized marketplace? Mm-hmm. Could you, like, go into that a bit further? Because it sounds interesting. And as I said earlier, also in the beginning, I'm a total newbie to that. So, feel free to elaborate.
Yeah, of course. So the dematerialized is, as I said, it's a digital fashion marketplace. Mm-hmm. We're building it for the future. It's 100% Web3 vision of a marketplace. We're redefining kind of like how the user journey is and the way to consume fashion, and specifically digital fashion. We believe you shouldn't buy fashion the same way you buy books on the internet. So that experience should look different. So we do a lot of research around like user experience and, you know, environments. We have a beautiful 3D environment in which the visitors can, the users can experience the products. And then every product that is for sale in the dematerialized is as an NFT, exists as an NFT. The users receive blockchain profiles under the hood. They don't even notice it. They believe they are managing just an email, but on the email we attach this universal receiver that allows them to receive the NFT without having MetaMask and Ether and all of this conundrum. And then as part of the user journey, then we go into the post-purchase experience once they have transacted, and it's about utility of a digital fashion garment. So we believe, you know, that's kind of like going to be the game changer, is in how many places can I experience this product. So at this point, you know, we have kind of like this option to wear it into a game. So we have it optimized to go into Sansar and VR chat. And then obviously trade it and display it, and then wear it. Sometimes, depending on the product, we have like kind of like the augmented reality version. So you just wear it on yourself digitally. Mm-hmm. Right now we're in closed beta though, so it's invitation only. We did a drop 2 weeks ago, was very successful. We sold out within 10 minutes. Then the next day we did a last product drop. It sold out in less than 20 seconds. So we're definitely—
You're part of the hype then.
Yeah, and we're really, totally. I mean, people want, and it just shows you there's a huge appetite, you know? And one of the things that we discovered is that one of the products were digital earrings. And and you could wear them with a Snapchat filter. And they were really big earrings, very minimalist, but they were big. And then a lot of our guys from our crypto community in Twitter, they were wearing them in social media, like they were posting the pictures. So it just shows a little bit like the relationship within the materiality. I think when a product is digital and you're enhancing yourself, people feel way more free and all of this gender thing starts dissolving, and that all of a sudden the guys have no problem showing very flamboyant earrings on the internet, which I don't think they will do in real life.
And how is the price? I mean, how much actually variety there is, and yeah, right, I always want to talk at the same time.
There are so many questions that come into mind, right? But even like, yeah, if I mean, for example, if I'm now like the creator, like a designer, a creator who can design like those digital earrings, like where do I need to go in order to be that creative person? Is it like kind of the ether blockchain or somehow, or like how does it work from, on the one hand, the designer creator perspective, as well as the consumer, me then want to put out those digital earrings?
Yeah, so what you as a designer have to do in order to enter this space, you mean? That's what you mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I think, you know, for a designer, obviously, I think, and this is my theory, is that NFTs will do for the design world and the art world, kind of like what social media did for content production. Mm-hmm. That all of a sudden the power dynamics were disrupted and the bigger players were not the established companies. Like Vogue doesn't have as many followers in Instagram as Chiara Ferragni, for example. You know, like it's just all of the sudden, and you know, like 10 years ago Vogue would have never put somebody like Chiara Ferragni on the cover, but all of a sudden Chiara Ferragni is more important than them, so she has a possibly bigger influence than even Vogue does at this point. So the power dynamic was disrupted through social media. So I think from the consumption dynamic, that's what NFTs is going to do, right? And you know, people say the Web 2 was a revolution around communications and the Web 3 is a revolution of value, right? It's the internet of value, what we're creating. The Web 2 was the internet of communication. All of a sudden we can do things like that, and like we're doing now, which is amazing. But the Web 3 will bring value into a lot of these things. So we believe the NFTs are going to do that. So one of the avenues, obviously, anybody with a computer and the ability of using a 3D program is potentially a creator, mm-hmm. Or any type of digital design tool. And then it comes down to how do you put that into a pipeline that will provide with an actual supply of utilizable assets. And this is the part with, I think, Luxo is the only player actually doing that in a very friendly manner. Basically, when somebody enters our pipeline, and that gets very well demonstrated on the Dematerialize, once they enter that pipeline, you go from just having a 3D file effectively to having a product that has very clear supply, very clear economics, very clear utility. Like I can take it into this game, I can do this, I can use this filter, I can do all of this stuff, right? Mm-hmm. So it's about creating the tools for creators to make it very easy to actually issue those collections, but allowing those products to have utility, right? Because deploying an NFT on Ethereum is something that pretty much anybody could do. Like if any of us sits down for more than 3 hours, we would figure it out. But it doesn't necessarily mean that you could sell it, but it doesn't necessarily mean that there's an utility behind it. And I think that's the part, like when we move past the hype cycle and we want to enter a market that has a certain level of normalization, that consumption is super important.
We actually also talked a lot about, you know, like the positive impact, also the great opportunities that are arising from the NFTs. What would you say, on the other hand, where do you actually see the biggest challenges currently, or maybe also the biggest risks for consumers?
Sorry, I think I missed the last part of the question. What did you say?
I just asked, like, where do you actually currently, or where do you see the biggest challenges, or also maybe some risk in this whole development?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are more opportunities than there are challenges. I think obviously one of the challenges are, you know, to make sure that the community finds a level of consensus about what are the standards that are being utilized. I think that's very important. I think, you know, one of the challenges is moving away from the hype cycles. I love hype cycles. I think they're fun. You know, it's great. But I think long-term, once you want to have an economy that is established, you want to have people buying these products on a regular basis and not everything selling out for exorbitant numbers, which is nice and I love it, you know. And in the Dematerialize, we do a bit of both. We test a lot of the pricing mechanisms. We had some very high like 9,000 euros for a garment, which is very expensive. Like spend 9,000 euros in a store is like significant. And we had other products for like 90 euros. So basically trying different pricing mechanisms. So I think one of the challenges would be like finding that normalization within the markets, in the sense that, yeah, you want to buy digital goods, NFTs, as, you know, maybe regularly, and don't break your bank account every time you buy one.
That's true. I was also, because someone even asked it in the chat, because you mentioned a couple of times, like the universal profile. I think that still raises a couple of question marks. Could you maybe elaborate like what that actually is in detail, and how you designed it with Fabian?
The universal profile. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so basically the universal profile is, the idea behind it is to have your unique identifier in the blockchain world. So basically it's the source where people will go to verify if you are the issuer or the owner of a specific giving asset. But that identity should also be your little manufacturer, which allows you to issue NFTs. So from that profile, you can identify yourself, say, yo, this is me. Mm-hmm. But you can also issue by just clicking through issue an NFT that is not registered on a marketplace or registered on a specific website under their profile or whatever under that. It's basically your asset that you issue under your identity. And then with that same profile, you have the ability of receiving those digital goods as well. And the idea is to be having the management of that account to be very simple. You know, right now, blockchain accounts, they have high levels of security because people learn the lesson the hard way when they lost X amount of thousands of hundreds of billions of dollars. We all know the stories because they didn't back up their keys. So now the applications force you to back up the key, et cetera. But, you know, we do believe I don't need the same security for me wanting to buy a T-shirt that if I'm putting my family's wealth in a bank account in Switzerland. Like, I want two different levels of security at those 2 points in time, right? So if I want to buy a T-shirt, I need very little security. If I want to put $1 billion, maybe I want more security. So we see also kind of like the security increasing through time, effectively in 1 point after a specific threshold in which you hold assets that value more than $10,000, for example, you go through the next security kind of like upgrade in which you have to take more control of your private key, and so on, so on, so until you basically potentially have 100% control of your account by yourself. And obviously we're thinking about all kind of like solutions to have multisigs and all of the stuff also that the guys at Kenosis have developed around, like, you know, you shouldn't have just one key for your main account. You should have a multi-signature with several keys in case something goes out, you can still gain access to your account.
And is that also like this, just the security as one of the applications, or if you would, for example, like predict for the next 3 to 5 years, what do you think, like, where's the biggest potential even? Like security, like how it can evolve, the ease of, how things getting easier, or like in general, like obviously taking the mission into consideration and making blockchain mainstream adoption, like where do you see like what's gonna evolve in the next 3 to 5 years?
I think it goes down to ease of use. It has to be simple, right? Like the fact that you want to own a crypto kitty doesn't mean that you now have to become a crypto expert, right? And I think For better or worse, most of us don't know how most things work, but we use them. Like going from pipes and aqueducts, we just enjoy that we have clean water in our houses, to our cars, we barely know how any of those things work. And I think with blockchain, because it's so kind of like ethereal, people really want to understand what it is because they can't really see it or touch it. Like you can touch the car, or, you know, it's like very, very in the air. So people really try to understand, but I think it's going down to, you don't need to understand all of this stuff. You just need interfaces that allows you to communicate and you know, utilize this. And for all that matter, most people don't understand the web too. You know, they're also not gonna know how the internet works, you know, and then, you know, and we're all happy utilizing it because we have a lot of really wonderful applications that have been built by kind of like the tech titans that we have right now. And I think we will see, like, as we move in this kind of like more decentralized ecosystem, we will have also maybe a larger array of applications that we might be interacting with. They potentially are not driven by very large corporations, but at the end, it's all about like you being in control of your ownership, you're being in control of your data, you're being in control of your profile, and just gaining access to different experiences when you need to.
Yeah. And you mentioned that you have like, let's say 10 or so use cases also mentioned in the white paper that you published.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
They're is that mostly, publicly available, or where can yeah. people actually find more
about it? It's publicly available. Junsik can drop the link in here. We have it on our website, but just if it's not super visible, you guys, he will put the link. It's, you know, it's just a very good kind of like description of like what, you know, the vision and the mission for Luxo. It's been praised by a lot of people, and that's one of the documents that have helped us pretty much onboard, especially executives who don't come from the tech world and the blockchain world, in order to tell them like, yeah, look, this is an amazing technology. We can do a lot of things with it. And then, you know, they get excited. And our mission with the white paper was not to have like a typical tech white paper. Like we have technology papers for that, but our white paper was meant to kind of like show and demonstrate what that technology can do. So an investor told me once, like, this sounds like a sociology, anthropology research piece. And I was like, well, I'm not an anthropologist, so here we go.
So when I have a look in the chat, I just see that you have already a few more downloads.
It was like Scott already downloaded it.
Very good.
Before, we also opened the floor for some questions from the audience. Maybe just one last quick question from my side. So is there any particular piece of advice from your experiences that you could share maybe with some founders in that space, or maybe also, you know, like entrepreneurs who just are super excited to actually start in the whole blockchain space, or especially maybe in the whole NFT space?
I think a good advice will be just pretty much educate yourself and go to good sources of knowledge. There's a lot of like bad science out there, like a lot of bad articles that journalists sometimes they write terrible things, and there's a lot of half-baked knowledge in the internet. So I think will be like making proper research, going down to the source, go to ethereum.org and check which papers they have published, which articles they have published, check what Luxo is publishing, like go to the right sources and like educate yourself. And I think just effectively try to utilize the tools that are available right now and see how we can make them better. And, you know, I think another thing is like be ready to face a lot of like, you know, people who are skeptical. And I was once in a meeting with this very good looking and very well-dressed guy who is like the definition of cool. And, you know, he had everything, the perfect watch, the perfect t-shirt, the perfect everything. And then he told me, the problem with digital goods is they don't have any utility and the price has nothing to do with the value. And then I was looking at his Supreme t-shirt thinking like, how do I tell him that his t-shirt is worth $5, but he paid possibly $300? And that value, that perceived value of his t-shirt is just what digital assets kind of like capture, right? There is digital craftsmanship and there is an utility for digital goods and there is a value in the creativity behind a digital good. And I think a lot of people, you know, sometimes even me included, we have to kind of like move away from that perception that value has something to do with something that we can touch. And that's why people, you know, have a skepticism around cryptocurrencies, because they like their paper money, but it's like your paper money is like means nothing. It's your paper money is just as virtual as any other money, just that it's controlled by central authorities. At least Bitcoin is not controlled by anyone. So, you know, it's just facing the skepticism. There's a lot of people that are skeptical. My co-founder, Karina, from the Dematerialized, she posted yesterday, everybody calls you crazy until they realize you were right, and then they call you a genius or something like that, she posted, right? And then I think it's just being brave enough to stand up for your ideas. Be fine that some people will express funny thoughts and very naive, and I think understanding the most humans, me included, we are a bit we don't like change, and we like to assume things will stay the same, but the basic premise is they won't stay the same and things are going to change, so we better adapt, right? So yeah, but educating yourself is the best thing. I cringe every time when I'm a meeting and I face a founder that I know he hasn't read any proper piece of documentation.
And obviously, mm-hmm. there are also so many communities, even on Discord, Telegram, and wherever. So I think it's always the first step would be, on the one hand, educate yourself, do your own research, but then also go out and talk to people, because that's the best way to get challenged and actually also see, like, am I there yet?
Well, I get like a panic attack every time I open my Telegram, because I get like 3 trillion messages from scammers. So I, you know, yes, join smart forums and smart chats, but I think be very selective too. I mean, there's a lot of like environments that are not necessarily very smart, especially in Telegram. So I think it's just find the right community, you know, inform yourself, have a discussion with somebody that you truly respect. Like I always, when I have an idea, I go and present to somebody that I think will be the toughest fighting partner, somebody who I know is going to destroy it. And if I survive the destruction, possibly it's a really good idea. So, you know, if I have a fashion related idea for NFTs, I call any of my advisors and see how much can I excite them? Or, you know, like just really find good sparring partners who will be really tough on you. And I think that's also very important. Like, find people who will tell you the truth in your face and challenge you, but in a constructive way.
Then let's jump in some of the questions from the audience.
I've seen Jonsik also answered a couple of them. Yeah. Maybe let's just raise them if you want to add any comments on them.
Yeah.
Hold on, I think Lee posted the first one. I have some artwork on Mintable. Yeah. The reason I went to this platform was simply to test and see what happens. Plus, it's free for me, no monetary investment. What benefit is there, and why would or should or could I choose to use another platform?
You should choose whatever you like more. So you just go there, you check their website, you go through the user journey, and whatever you like, you use. And whatever brings you the best experience and brings your products into the hands of people and potentially gives you financial gain, that's the platform you should choose.
Okay, that's a good answer. Another question from Alex. For me, blockchain technology is a very new world. May I ask you, of curiosity, what is the CO2 impact of running data center energy for blockchain technology with regards to our environment?
Well, I don't have any data points stored in my brain at the moment, so I cannot drop any numbers. So I think I think Google is a better source than me, and I'm pretty sure there's a lot of articles around that. But you know, this is again going back to what I was saying before about finding proper sources of content and not just going around whatever is getting published in mainstream media, because that can be dangerous. I mean, journalists are great, but you know, sometimes they have to write about stuff that they don't know, and they're also trying to learn, right, while they are writing the pieces. So the whole conundrum about energy consumption is mostly related to the Bitcoin blockchain, and it's because the Bitcoin blockchain uses proof of work, which is indeed the most decentralized consensus algorithm, but it's not necessarily the most sustainable in that sense, because it's based on a kind of like competition and in a race, and it is basically anybody can run a Bitcoin node, us included. You know, at the beginning, 10 years ago, was really easy. You could do it with a semi-normal computer, but the more computer power enters the network, the complexity and the protocol increases. So the protocol has a lot of intelligence built into it. So all of a sudden, people realize the more computer power I put in, the more higher chances I have to get the block reward, and the block reward was a couple of Bitcoins, which doesn't make it an unsexy business model. So people start kind of like that race started, and a lot of people decided to get a supercomputer, and then they got 2 supercomputers, and then they said, oh, I will with my body get 10 computers. And then that's kind of like how mining farms were born. Mm-hmm. And it's just that race to who's going to get the block reward, right? But that's very Bitcoin specific. There's a bunch of other consensus algorithms, and now the Ethereum blockchain, which is the blockchain who kind of introduce smart contracts, and that's the reason why NFT exists, because we can deploy smart contracts on the network. And Luxo is a Ethereum-like blockchain. We do use a lot of the Ethereum technology for our own network. So Ethereum has developed this thing called Casper, and it's a proof of stake algorithm. Luxo is going to deploy it as well, and a proof of stake is inherently much more sustainable. We did some research calculated around maybe 90% less energy consumption, just because there's no race around who has the beefiest computer. It's the race who has the largest stake. So the more you can stake, the higher chances you have to receive the reward. And if you were to do something malicious, then you will lose your stake. So there it is.
That was a very good answer.
Thank you.
Conscious of your time, maybe just a final question to wrap it up a bit. Like, is there anything that you are particularly excited about these days? And also, what's actually the next milestone for Luxo?
In the recent days, I live in a constant state of excitement. That's why I injure my neck and I don't notice, because I'm in a constant state of excitement, because all of this just very, very nice to see, that this stuff is entering the larger cultural conversation. And that's very, it just feels really good with something that you've been interested in for many, many years, and that it felt very niche, all of the sudden seems to be something that everybody's interested. So I live in Mitte, and I was in the Hochstädte, and there were these two old men, they're always there, and they were saying NFT, NFT. And I was like, are they saying NFTs? I was like, oh my God, they're talking about NFT. So having these old German gentlemen talking about NFT just made my day and my life. I was so excited. I just think I'm just excited around like mainstream adoption of consumption. And I think Luxo will play a tremendous role in that. And you know, our next milestone is we're going to deploy most of the stuff that we've been working on towards the end of the year. So we're going to launch our mainnet. Right now we have a test network where all of the stuff is running. We're going to deploy the testnet that, as I said, is going to be very, very innovative, because it's the first network to implement the Casper consensus. And then we, together with the mainnet, we are orchestrating a very aggressive kind of like go-to-market strategy with a lot of partners.
There you go.
Marijke, shall we then also say a few final words to Startup Grind, and maybe also the next
Maybe just one last thing from Marjorie. Yeah. If people want to get a hold of you or want to learn more and connect with you, we all know that you're super busy, but what's the best place where they can go?
Well, they should go to our Discord channel. I'm sure Junsik is going to post the link, because he's on top of everything tonight.
I see he's everywhere, like a social butterfly.
He's amazing. He's from Korea and a key part of our team, based in Berlin as well. He will post a Discord. The Discord channel is the best location, because it's just the time. This is where we do our internal communications. The whole team communicates over our Luxo servers. So we are always on Discord, and we have obviously the public channels where we publish a lot of news, and also we check it out. So Discord is a great place. Also, you know, we try to process all of the inquiries that come to hello@luxo.io or hello@luxo.network. So you can always send an email, and you know, there will be always somebody who eventually will drop an eye. The answering loops are sometimes a bit long, unfortunately, but we try to keep our best to answer all of the requests. And then I think Discord is a great place to hang out. And you know, there's an open community channel for developers, so even Fabian answers questions in there. He takes a lot of time, so it's great.
That's great. Amazing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously with Startup Grind, we as an international community, we also love to help each other out. So if there's, let us know, please, also if there's anything that we can do for you, spread
Thank
the word.
You.
If you're hiring also, we also have a large talent pool of smart people.
Oh, definitely. We do. We are seriously understaffed.
You guys go to Marjorie then.
If you need a job, write me or write Junsik and we will funnel you. I don't want to be very mean, but I will put the email of my assistant. She will murder me. She can take it.
And you know what? This is, I think, what Startup Grind is also kind of about, right? It's really, for us, like for Mike and me, it's always like fascinating, right? To just always dive into, you know, like new industries, always like inspiring people. And then at a certain point, you always come together, right? So, I mean, like also for you guys, I mean, we are doing this on a monthly basis, as you saw at the beginning, right? Startup Grind is a global community. We are actually right now in more than 600 cities. And obviously we are always happy to bring in some new ideas also from our community to the Berlin chapter. We have actually a great team. So Marijke and I are doing this together with some of the lovely faces or people here. So thank you guys also for always helping us out. We also have some great partners and sponsors, especially like the team from BMH Bräutigam. Unfortunately, Sebastian is not here today, but he just reached out to me, and I should say greetings from him. So I think you can always reach out to him if you have any legal stuff. Same goes for the team from AWS. But just to wrap it up, thank you again also for your time. I think we all got a great overview about like the whole industry. And as Marijke said, always happy to come back also to a later point of time, or if there's anything we can do, let us know.
Yeah. Amazing. That was so lovely. So many amazing questions. Thank you to both of you for inviting me. It was surely a thrill, and hopefully, maybe we can have a second one in the near future
and hopefully soon in person in Berlin then.
Yeah, that would be so nice to imagine. Actually,
we all miss that, I guess, right?
Totally. Yeah. All right, guys.
Okay, perfect. Then, stay safe.
Evening.
Enjoy the evening. Safe. Thank you so much for your time. Tune in next month, and stay healthy and get vaccinated.
Thank you. Bye, guys.
Take care, guys.
Bye. Bye.